It's Chuck from Above the Basement, Boston Music and Conversation, the official podcast partner of the 2017 Boston Music Awards. 2017 sees the Boston Music Awards celebrate their 30th anniversary on December 7th at House of Blues in Boston. Tickets are open to the public and on sale now via the Boston Music Awards website at bostonmusicawards.com. The night will feature multiple live performances from nominated artists, and winners will also be announced that night, so if you want to see who wins firsthand, make sure you grab tickets. Okay, so maybe you ran into Ryan in an apple orchard in Vermont, or possibly downtown Burlington. Perhaps you've heard him on the radio as lead singer and guitarist in the acclaimed group Guster. Ryan has built a career in scoring for film and also hosts a PBS TV show aptly called Makin' Friends with Ryan Miller, where he travels the great state of Vermont speaking with high-functioning weirdos. I am making the quotes gesture with my fingers as I say that. We discovered that Ryan is a creative force in many ways when he kindly invited us to his home for a great conversation. So here is that conversation with Ryan Miller, recorded at an undisclosed location near Burlington, Vermont.
We're rolling, baby.
Thanks for having us at your house, man.
Yeah, this was the path of least resistance. We got to do
it. Worked, and we got our last little morning in Burlington.
Well, I'm sure that this will provide some context for whatever we're going to talk about.
Yeah,
maybe it depends.
It's the epicenter.
I haven't. Are we on? Are we doing this right now?
We're on.
Okay, cool. Cheers, looks good. You had that weird look in your face with the beer. I was like, I'm just going to close this loop.
Wow, you should have seen me at Red Square last night.
I know. I wish that I had, but you've been here before, so I didn't really need to lay out where you needed to go.
No.
Yeah,
that's cool.
But also, it's
changed so much. Like you said, there's like a million breweries.
Especially out here in like the burbs, there's all these places that are literally like, they've popped up in when you say Williston, because that's where we are. I live in Williston. Yeah. It's like the first thing people think of is Walmart and Home Depot and Best Buy, because there's a whole strip mall vibe about 2 miles away from me.
Right.
But obviously we are not near that, since we are now in the woods with a nice view.
I don't have that vibe here.
But people don't know that. It's like a weird secret thing about Williston, where I kind of have this weird Williston pride. I'm like, well, no one knows about this place, but I guess I'm telling people about it now.
But you're also nice and high up. You got an awesome little view of the...
I saw this house for the first time when I was flying, because we're in the flight path of BTV.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah, right. You saw the place literally from the plane?
Yeah, because we lived on this other road, and I was like, wait, what are all those houses up there? Because it's kind of snuck up here. It's not like
I want to live there.
I want to, like, where is that? What are all those weird houses? And then something came up, and this is the top house. Like, this house used to have an antenna on it, so in the 70s, airplanes wouldn't smash into it. Which is a little scary. I don't really like telling that to my kids.
Yeah,
like,
that's pretty
low. They already have enough irrational fears in their life.
Right.
It's like, oh, a spider web is going to hurt me. And like, no, it's just a spider web. An airplane might smash into your window before a spider web hurts you, son. That's not good parenting.
It's more probable, probably.
I purposely didn't listen to what you
that's
guys
fine.
Do because I
fine.
Knew we had mutual friends.
That's fine. So. We don't know who you are either.
Okay, great. Fine. Then that's why we're all here.
This whole area of the country is really special to me. We hung out with my family last night or 2 nights ago, and you know, we wanted to have the opportunity to talk to you.
All right.
And then also we killed two birds with one stone. We talked to Justin at Burlington.
Yeah, what was your connection to Justin?
I saw an article about it, and I'm a newly born vinyl.
Me too.
Guy.
We could get into that if you want to.
Yeah, sure. I'd love to. And so anyways, I reached out to him and said, hey, you know, what if we got you on the podcast, if you ever made it up there? And that was like a year ago.
Oh, yeah.
And then when we got you to come on, I'm like, oh, well, let's see if we can talk to him. So,
yeah.
And he was fantastic.
And he was good
great,
conversationalist.
Great guy. Really smart. They took these unbelievable chances to start this
record
company.
The origin story there is pretty nuts, too.
Yeah, and then the story about him getting that, like, searching the world for the machine, found it in Germany.
Like, putting it back together.
He built another one from scratch.
Yeah, that's awesome.
So now he can double his production. And
that's one thing I love about this town, is that people know how to do things. I got here and my neighbor's a woodworker, and I was like, can you help me build a bookshelf? You know, like, I feel like I got here and I wanted to make stuff. And even just now, I bought a car that's 4,000. Are you guys car guys? You know about cars?
Not really.
You know about cars, Adam?
No,
damn it.
Yeah.
See, I don't know anything about. I bought a car from kind of a shyster because he's like, oh, it was perfect. And it died completely. So the guy at Toyota's like, oh, you spent $4,000 on this car. It's going to cost $8,000 to fix it. But he was a mechanic. And I was like, can I just ask you some other questions about cars? Like, what year Toyota? He's like, oh, that's the problem with yours. It has ABS. And before the 96, so they had the 3.6. And I was like, oh, man, to know things. Like, everybody here knows shit about shit. I don't know anything. Like, I mean, I can talk to people, but I don't know about stuff.
Well, when you talk to people throughout the state, that's kind of a thing for you too. What you've actually done?
Oh, my Makin' Friends.
Makin'
thing?
Friends.
Yeah.
So did you? I mean, did you make a friend with that guy?
Or? Well, it was a little less formal because he wants to buy my car for parts, and I was like, well, do you mind now that I have you on the phone? I mean, the thing about the community here is it feels like we just went away for the weekend, and there's a new community that we're being involved with up around the lake, and we just kind of met all these people, and I was seeing Vermont from the outside for the first time. Yeah. I mean, I'm perennially an outsider because I've only been here for 7.5 years, but like feeling like a new Vermont, being like, wow, people are so nice. Yeah. And I had just spent the last week in LA and New York, and I have very strong feelings about community and what that means in all these different places. And Vermont for me personally is like, one of the challenges has been there's not, even you and I were just talking about this, Adam, about how there's a community here, but it's hard to like, people don't get out of their comfort zones, I think, in the same way that LA and New York, where you have to be a professional networker just by dint of your own personality, that's what feeds you. So getting out in Vermont and meeting all these people, I like I know a much wider variety of people than I would ever know anywhere else, but I really appreciate that about Vermont.
You're actually living in it and seeing it rather than, like you said, from the outside, well, that concept sounds... It makes sense.
Exactly.
But now you're organically doing it.
Right. So my neighbor is a brewer, and my other neighbor is an anesthesiologist woodworker. And then this dude is a car mechanic or a chef or a restaurateur. Like, I don't think I would have the variety of people in my life that I have here, which I tend to appreciate. But as a professional creative person who is constantly looking to collaborate on all kinds of things, it can be really hard because there's not a lot of touring musicians here. There's not a lot of film composers here. Yeah. There's not a lot of people who have TV shows here. So that part can be hard. And if you look for it here, you're going to ultimately be disappointed. It might actually be true of a lot of things in Vermont. There's not a lot of anything here. So you have to be very much a self-starter, very self-reliant in order just to come here, because you don't show up and get a job and then work at your job. You got to figure out what the hell you're going to do.
Yeah. Well, and you know, we were talking about Justin at the Record Plant is a perfect example. And we talked about early 80s with Ben and Jerry. That's the quintessential where they just started this vision. And there's something about Vermont, I think, that, I don't know, it's Darwinian, people just sort of will come here for that common bond, in a sense.
There is, you know, and it's funny being a somewhat accidental ambassador to Vermont. Like when I go to LA and I go to New York and I go out there into the universe, and like, I live in Vermont. Like, I've been here for 7.5 years. My kid's 8 years old. Like, we moved here when he's 2 weeks old, you know? So like, my wife is from here. That's the reason we're here. Having settled into an existence here, and like, I'm constantly looking for like the weirder people, but they really dug in. They don't exist on this top frothy layer, like where I was in LA and I'm like, oh, what's up? Like, super famous person or really great musician or cool producer or like music bro I've toured with. Like, all those people exist out in the open and they're easy to pluck out. But
you
like
gotta
the Makin' Friends
out.
Idea, I have a show on Vermont PBS where I would find these high functioning weirdos that were kind of dug in, and they do have a community, but they're very hard to sort of suss out because they kind of exist in these little crags, you know? It's like the sea urchins of the thing. It's like they're doing cool shit, but you got to really kind of go find them.
So how did you find them?
Well, I started a TV show. Literally is what the whole idea was. My friend who works for Vermont PBS was like, saw an interview with me online and was like, hey, I think you'd be good to do a TV show for Vermont PBS. Do you have any ideas? And, you know, we kind of wanted to be an interview. I was like, yeah, let's find me some friends. Like, let's call Makin' Friends with Ryan Miller. We'll go find high-functioning weirdos because I like really eccentric people, but also people that do cool shit. Because that way it was like, well, if it's not a good show, at least I'll make friends. Like, I think I can say my best friend I met on the show. Like, I had 12 episodes. I'm in touch with half of them and really, really good friends with three of them. And I'd like to keep doing it. Like, I'm trying to figure out how to do it on a national level because I really like you, I find people interesting. And especially like if they're vetted and you're like, oh, that guy, how does he do that? Yeah. And like, it's something I feel like I can do well, but it's a hard place to do it from here. But it almost made it cooler because the people here are really... They're really weird.
Were they
really
reluctant to come on?
And they're really high functioning. Some
they
of
are.
Them.
I mean,
so,
some
I mean,
of them are
Magic
cool.
Hat guy.
Yeah, like yeah. Alan is obviously a guy who did Magic Hat and Seventh Generation and started a bunch of breweries and like is a perennial entrepreneur and a thinker. And the other person I think of when I think of him is like my buddy that started Brooklyn Bowl. Like, they have so much in common with the way they think about things, even though Alan is based here. And my buddy Paul Budnitz, who started Kid Robot and Ello and Budnitz Bicycles, and like,
what do you think they have in common?
All 12 of them, or
what's the thread? You think? If you think about these 12 episodes, yeah, what's the weirdo thread?
The high functioning weirdo really is an encapsulator in terms of the weirdo part. Is that they're slightly off axis? Like all of those people, I could go through. John Cohn is the IBM fellow who's just like is out of his mind, just like a crazy thinker, and is like. Totally not unself-aware, but doesn't care about what people think. I think it's a great question, but I think the through line, a lot of it is like unabashed creativity, yeah. Best idea wins, really unconcerned with the way people view you, and really concerned with like visiting with the muse. But the thing is about all these really various people is that we end up talking about creativity. We talk, a lot of them are artists in some level. We end up with a very distilled version of what it means to be a creative person and what it means to live in Vermont and in this context. And also to be kind of unconcerned with the way people view you. And that's the weirdo component. And also that there's real value in being weirdo. And like weirdo is like, the most unpejorative term that you can ever think of, because I've really value the weird people, and like, and I think that's kind of what I want in my life. I'm trying to fill my life with really eccentric, weirdo, off-axis people, but who also make stuff, who do shit. I have a lot of respect for people that put themselves out there and just put their stamp on something and make something.
Well, it's a fearlessness, right?
Yeah, and sure, absolutely.
I mean, certainly there might be fear there, but you're willing to deal with the consequences of whatever you're going to do. You're willing to deal with failure and move on to something else. And so the creativity, I mean, I don't know, I guess not everybody needs to face their fears to be creative, but certainly some people might. Again, I don't keep meaning to bring up Justin again. He's not an engineer. He's not a.
Yeah.
He went in there totally blind. He's a car guy, I think, right? I think
he's a big
right.
Car
so,
guy.
He had the mechanical
so he had a mechanical part.
He had the passion
so he
for
can figure
vinyl
it out.
Ish or the yeah. Spirit.
But he started from zero. Exactly. He had the spark that he wanted. He's like, this is a great idea. And he just followed it.
Well, so let me ask you, let me put it to you. So, how many episodes are we on? 50 something?
This is 58.
All right. So, was there a through line between the people that you're interested in talking to? Like, how do you guys determine what it is that you're interested in?
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, the whole idea of above the basement, these were people at one point in their lives who decided to stop jamming in their basements and start playing live. They took their art outside of that, you know, the metaphorical basement.
It's a comfort zone. Get out of your basement.
Right. So there's a fearlessness in that, in playing your art in front of people and giving it out. And, you know, people who are still doing their day jobs and still trying to do music. Right. So there's that. There's certainly people who we've talked to who do music for a living, and that's great. But these are fearless people who decided to do something. And, you know, some we haven't talked to only musicians, but...
Yeah,
like I know you talked to our manager, Dalton.
We talked to Dalton.
He's not at all a music. No. But is an amazing human being.
And you know what? I would refer anybody listening to this this episode that Dalton's got a different perspective about the ride of grassroots and how from 95 it started for your music with Guster. Having that perspective as the guy that was in the trenches putting up signs on, you know, those colorful pieces of paper.
Oh, yeah.
Pinned up to a telephone pole.
Old school. He's the guy who put his belief in you guys, right? And threw everything into it.
Yeah, vice versa.
So,
sure.
Yeah. And
absolutely.
So, yeah. So I think that's the thread.
Christmas dance, maybe not getting her pants, whatever
Right now, you're working on the PBS special, but yeah. You also have a lot behind me. We have sitting a lot of instruments, and we have musical ideas and melodies that are probably are born here.
Oh, yeah, so, lots of stuff. I mean, this is...
Tell me about the birth of that
I mean, I think...
creativity.
I started a band in college with my friends, thinking we would just play music and be in a band, because I wanted to play in a band. When I got to college, I had been in a band in high school. It was really fun. I made great friendships. I was like, oh, that was fun. I'm medium at music. I'll just keep playing music. So we all met in Guster, like first day of school, because I had asked around, has anybody ever played music before? And I was looking mostly for bands, like dudes that had ever written songs. It was important for me to be with songwriters, because I knew, like, we were talking about Seth
Iacovone.
Yeah. I never know how to pronounce the last name. And like, he's an amazing musician, and I'm not an amazing musician. Like, I'm not a shredder. I don't know how to play. I can't sit in with people. I think my skill, even, you know, early on, was just kind of being a songwriter. So I met these fellow songwriters, and we all developed together and learned. And I knew nothing about music when I started. I mean, I had been cut exclusively on heavy metal on the radio, and then that segued into alternative rock, at the beginnings of alternative rock. So I showed up at college knowing about The Cure and Depeche Mode and New Order and The Smiths, but not knowing about Pet Sounds or Village Green by The Kinks or anything. Like, I didn't know about The Birds. I didn't know things that are just become What's Going On or Astro Weeks, you know, by Van Morrison, things that are now as much a part of my soul as anything. I had just was really late to the game. So we kind of all learned together about how to do this. And we were in a band and sort of accidentally became successful enough to support ourselves right out of school being a musician and never look back. It's a really big transition to be able to go full time. And it's a huge gap to speak to the basement thing. It's like, when do you move from going your day job? Because if you have to have a day job, and then that limits what you can do. And then, but once that's limiting, it's self-limiting and you can't really escape. So there's a huge gap that college really was the training wheels, because we were able to get out of college and make enough money to really support ourselves. Like, our parents weren't supporting us out of school. We were already making $700 playing at college gigs. So we were able to pay our rent with like a gig, and we did. And then we were just like
95,
writing music. Boom. Yeah, 95. So
when did you know that this was going to be a non-day job?
In terms of like breaks, what was your big break? There was something that happened when we were in college that we didn't realize would be as big of a deal. But basically, colleges book their acts for their schools, like their college activities. Like if people played at UVM, right? They would like have a band come in, but that paid really well. And we somehow got into that conference where all the people came. And it was called National Association of Collegiate Activities or something. And they accepted our demo, which we recorded in our basement. And then once we got on the showcase, we booked like 10 or 15 shows at $700 a piece. And then people from colleges would come from everywhere else, and especially in Boston, and they would disseminate. So like people from Northeastern all went back to New Jersey or went to Ohio. And that's how it got disseminated on a very grassroots level. Or like Boston was a place where everybody went to college and then went home in the summers and would tell their friends about this band. So
it was social media.
It was pre-internet. Like we did not have internet.
And the media was a cassette.
Media is a cassette, and we were pressing our own CDs, and we would set up our street team, and I'm going to go on record and say we were one of the first street teams ever in the fucking history, because we didn't know it. There was no such thing. People would be like, I like your band. And we're like, cool, here's 20 CDs. Here's your Guster rep name. We're going to call you Cantankerous. Here's your baseball card. And then when we come to University of Miami, Ohio, set up a show for us. We'll sleep on your floor. We'll hang out with you for 2 days, and you set up a show and bring your 200 friends. I'm telling you, this is all pre-internet. So that was like a really big part of our success. So it's a very grassroots thing. We're in the van for years and years, and then we slowly graduated bus and found Dalton. He was a manager, but he was just an accountant who was going to go to music school. But
Like,
don't go to music school. We got a label that wants to sign us. So then he negotiated a deal, and then we kind of like, we kept going, and it's been a very slow and steady process. I mean, we're not a big band. I'm friends with a lot of big bands. Like, I know a guy in the Foo Fighters. Like, that's a big band. Like, we're not a big band, but also I talk to other bands, and we're still like 25 years in. Like, you know, it's a thing. I don't know. This wasn't the bigger question, but I was in the band for a very long time and remain in the band, and it's a huge part of my creative output. But at a certain point, i.e. children for all of us, is when it really put fine point on like, what am I going to do? I make all my money from being in a bus. How the hell am I going to make money if I'm not in a bus? And I, my buddy and I wrote a movie together, like as a goof, because he was a screenwriter. And then it was like, oh, I'll score it. I don't even know what that means. And I started scoring it. And I was like, this is cool. I could do this from my house. This feels great. I love the movie industry. There's like a bunch of creative people. And I go to LA. So I was like, kind of set my sights on that and started doing commercials. And then I started doing films. I got really lucky with a guy I actually met in Vermont and did this movie, Safety Not Guaranteed. And he kind of took off from there. And then I kind of did a lot of Sundance movies after that. And I'm still kind of in that zone. And then, you know, the TV show is thing happening and I'm doing a bunch of songwriting. Like today I got to try and write an end credit song for a big animated movie. And so what happened 10 years ago, right when we all started having kids, was like, I needed to figure out how to stay creative with being in different states than my bandmates. And thing is about writing for commercials or writing for TV or writing for film is that I can just do it every day. I can just work. And I will, and that's what makes me happy is I need to work. I need to do something or else I start to go nuts. So that was the idea. And that's all I'm trying to fill my life with right now. How do I be collaborative? How do I work with people that are inspiring and that some enforce some new set of limitations that allows me to think outside of what I like to do? So the TV show was like, oh, this is great. I get to meet people. I get to like talk to people. And then after having done it 12 times, I'm like, wait, I really enjoy this. I feel like I'm really good at it. What do I do now? You know, so I'm in LA and I'm like, well, I like talking to weirdos. And usually I can meet people and it doesn't take too long for most people to kind of like relax into it. Mm-hmm. And we can have a real conversation about real stuff. So I'm trying to figure out what to do with that. I think at this point, I consider myself an artist. I used to air quote that thing, but I don't anymore. Like, that's what I do. I'm a professional creative person. And I
still, air quotes have left the basement.
They left the basement. Yeah. I'm not, I am totally an artist. Like, my kids, like, what's your dad do? He's a musician, he's an artist, you know, my wife's a writer. Like, we met someone yesterday. They're like, oh, what do you guys do? I'm like, I'm a musician. I'm an artist. And like, that's great. That's an amazing thing to be able to do.
A lot of people will kind of choke on that word artist.
I think I would forever.
You know, because it's, you know,
it seems pretentious.
Yeah, it does. But
I've never done anything else.
But you got to own it, right?
Yeah.
I mean, because that's
another option.
That's what you are, right? So what are you going to do? But I can understand the hesitancy to do that.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. Exactly.
But the beauty of everything that you're doing is that you're doing. I have a friend who's trying to figure out what the hell he was like. He was between jobs and just trying to figure out what to do. And he's like, I'm going to just do something. Just do something. It doesn't have to be huge or just as long as you're doing something.
It's really the advice. I just met with a friend of mine in LA and she's supermodel, actor. She's kind of got it all. And she's having this moment where she's coming off some really high profile things. And we had this conversation. She's like, I just don't know what to do. Like, I don't know what I'm going to do next. And I said, well, that's part of the problem. Like, if you think about this as a problem to be solved of like, well, I've been a really famous model and I've done this movie and I don't know if I want to act anymore. Or I have all these opportunities. I'm like, you're going to get crushed under the pressure. Find things that excite you. Do whatever it is. Just do something. And it's that advice of just like, you don't have to figure this thing out. I mean, even with my wife, I think I learned this from watching her because she meets people through me and we're like successful actors or producers or writers or musicians or, and it can be really intimidating because it's like, well, I don't feel that passionately about anything. Like she's a writer, but does she want to be a writer where she wants to like live and breathe and die and think about? No, I think she wants to teach yoga. I think she wants to read. And so we'll just find something you like to do and fill your life. When we left New York, she was waiting tables at a restaurant. She was also reading scripts for HBO. She was teaching yoga. She was writing for freelance writing. And I was like, that seems pretty cool. Like in aggregate, you have this life that you can piece together. This hits all these different points. But to try, I think there's a lot of pressure to find the one thing that's going to complete you.
Right.
That's what I was trying to let my friend off the hook. It's like, there may not be that thing. Like, what is it that you like about acting? Cool. Well, just find that for that. And what is it that you like about modeling? Making money? Great. Go take your money gigs. And if you want to find a young filmmaker, go make a movie for no dollars, but it'll scratch that itch. Like you can have this holistic version of your life that I think it takes a while for people to develop because you get hammered really early about these people who are singularly minded and who only think about one thing, which God bless them. I love those people. And I'm part of the people I want to meet. But for me, it was more like a little bit wider viewpoint instead of like, oh man, all I want to do is find that perfect sound. It's not that. It's like, well, just do a lot of different stuff.
Yeah.
It'll all add up into
it's
a life.
It's something that I totally remember when I got out of college. I'm like, what the hell am I going to do with my life? And it was a singular thought that I needed
to
do
something.
Job? This is my day job now. I got laid off last year, but but I was like, what LLC, am I gonna do,
baby?
Because that's the thing. When you get out of college, you're like, you're supposed to be in finance. You're supposed to be a teacher. You're supposed, you know.
Yeah, well, you were an actor.
Linear with that, yeah. So as well, I figured
you had things. You were a slasher.
I had things.
But, I call them slasher.
You're an actor, musician.
Yeah,
but slashing. I didn't know at the time that it wasn't about me being okay. I decided to be an actor, and that's my line. It certainly could be for some people. That's that straight line to whatever you're going to be doing the rest of your life, and that's the biggest point of what you do. Sometimes it's 20 different things that you're doing, and they may be connected. They may not even be connected.
Exactly.
But but as long as you're doing all those things, those make up the whole that can make you feel complete in whatever you're doing.
Exactly.
Well, it's creativity is one of the themes too, and happiness.
Yeah.
And it's like, it's hard to define happiness, of course. But
well, I think for me, it's also like being very on guard for like toxic people. I think for me, it's the people that are vaguely optimistic.
There are a lot of people that would have played in the band and given up after a while. And I'm sure you guys have had, you know, like all bands are going to have some issues over time. But there is something about when you ride the wave and you know that there's a credibility, there's something that's building.
Yeah, I mean, it's a weird thing to try and like pathologize the band in terms of its legacy and its history and where we're going. I think a lot of it does kind of ride on that energy. You know, people come to the shows, and we just did a show in Portland, Maine, and it was kind of a festival weekend. It was the first time we've ever kind of been like, come for the weekend and we'll do a bunch of weird stuff.
Yeah.
And 4,500 people showed up in Portland, Maine on an August weekend. And you know, this far into our band, and we still do really well, and you know, full stop, you know, for a band. But there it was like, oh, this is our real community. These are our like bread and butter. These are our hardcore fans who come. And I think a lot of what is the unifying force is a lot of that energy. It's like, obviously it's the tunes. Like I listen to music. I'm a voracious consumer of music. Your identification with a band to the point that you would go for a weekend is beyond music. It's the same reason people will travel for Wilco. I think the ultimate version of this, at least a contemporary example, is Fish. You know, I have to just say, because we were talking about it before, but like as a band, I don't have a lot of connection to their music. It just wasn't part of who I grew up. It's not really where I put my head musically these days, but I cannot say enough about what it is that they created. And it floors me that these like four dudes who play very obtuse music, very outside stuff, have encapsulated and crystallized a community that is unserved in any other kind of unifying way. Like they, of course they all have other communities, but like to create some version of that by these dudes and for this long doing exactly what they're doing is, I could not love something more. Just that's life. Like this is community and creativity and the whole thing.
There really is a common language and culture. Seeing Fish a long time ago, seeing them grow, I was in 89, so it was sort of very early on that first couple years. And Greg, our mutual friend Greg, remembers you and Brian, right?
Yeah. Brian.
Just with some kungas and a guitar in the study hall or whatever it was. It's the music, but it's also those melodies and those memories that you make while you're listening to that music when you're young.
It's so convoluted. Like people's relationship to our band and my relationship to other bands. Like I get recognized not very frequently, but maybe once a day, especially in other towns and stuff. Yeah. And people are very respectful. And I'll just take a sidetrack. Like I have a friend who has been on tour with Paul McCartney for the last, you know, 10 years in some capacity. And I asked him, you know, what was it like meeting McCartney? And he's like, oh, it was the least disappointing thing that could ever happen, which A, is a really great way. And I've used that to say about other people.
I like that. That's
it's
a nice
such
way
a good way to talk about it. But B, I was like, well, what's it like when people meet McCartney? And when you meet Paul McCartney, every conversation is the same. It's about them telling Paul McCartney what Paul McCartney means to them and Paul allowing that to happen, which is such a high level of dealing with fame and being like, okay, you're meeting me, but this is really about you telling me about this thing.
Right.
But as it relates to us, it's like, obviously it's not the Beatles and obviously it's not Paul McCartney, but when people do come to me, usually they out themselves. They're like, it always starts with Saw You. Saw You, Paradise 97, or the thing that kind of gets me through that, because it's not that exciting for me for you to tell me you saw me in 2003 at Assumption College. Like, okay. But
you say I saw you too?
Yeah. It's like,
I remember you.
I go through all the things. I try and do the same thing. I was just like, oh, that's beautiful. When I was in 2003, all I wanted to do at Assumption College was to connect with somebody. And that's all I try and do every night, is to go out and like be real. The fact that that even gets to come to me once a day or once a week or whatever, where people have an association with my music and the stuff that we've made, I know that this is important, that whatever we make now connects with people. We constantly think we're going to make the best record we ever make next. It's hard to say. Like, I know that Lost and Gone Forever for a lot of people was also like a huge record for us. But I feel like our last record had a lot of breakthroughs on some level too. And people who, whose opinion I respect were like, yeah, I didn't really like your band until the last record. It's like, great.
Well, not every record's going to speak to everybody, but I'm always more interested in the band that's going to do something different on every album.
The thing that really informs a lot of what we do is that we're all fans of music and bands. So it's like, I know if I go see LC Sound System, I really like the new record, but there's like, I need to hear some of my jams. You know, like Sound of Silver was just like part of who I was for like 3 years. Or I just like, and I've heard this anecdotally, I don't know if this is true, but that Counting Crows, like Adam Duritz never sings like Mr. Jones, that he's just got to feel it, which as an artist, I totally get. But it's like, well, people are paying $65.
They want to hear it.
Yeah, like I saw Tom Petty do like 25 nights at the Fillmore, like one night of the 25 nights. And I think he had to really stretch it out. And I'm a massive Petty fan, so this is no knock on him whatsoever. But he did American Girl like half speed. And I'm like, that's interesting. But I want to see you play American Girl, Tom Petty. Like, I know where you're coming from, but you got to see where I'm coming from. I'm seeing Tom Petty at the Fillmore, and I want to see American Girl at like 134 beats per minute or whatever it is. I don't know what it is. It'd be great to Google it.
Just switching a little gears into your collaborative film work, I read something about it where there's a change where the music drives things in a different way. That there's something about the feel of that movie that and the music really helps that change.
I think in all films that I'm doing, I mean, Safety was my first film, so I was really, or it was my second movie, but my first like real movie with other people involved. Yeah. I wasn't just working with the director who found funding. Figuring out what role music played in movies is something I am discovering as I go. But I think I understood even back then that like, music had to start somewhere and have a middle, beginning and a middle and end, just like a film. And it's the biggest cliche ever for a composer to be like, I just think of the score as another character in the film. Like,
what's the most challenging thing for you that you didn't think would be challenging?
As a composer?
As a composer for a film.
I really pride myself on being able to like get people and figuring out how to speak their language and kind of be on their side. But I'm also sort of doing this remotely, which is hard, like being in Vermont. What I figured out too is just like, well, you're looking for something, and I do a thing. And usually there's a Venn diagram. If we get together and make a decision to do it, we can thread that thing, and we can both make something beautiful. But sometimes it's like, maybe I'm not the guy you need. I don't do everything. Like, figuring out what it is that I do really well, I could try this, and this would be great and super fun for me, but I go see other people that do it. I'm like, you're killing this. Like kind of figuring out what it is that I do really well and realizing sometimes it's like, it's not personal. Maybe I'm just not what you need right now. Maybe it's what I need. You need 6 months ago or 6 months from the future, but it's not what you need right now. My few failures as a composer where I like, that didn't work out. You know, I can kind of figure out what it is. A lot of it is a personality match too, and just getting inside someone's head so you guys, everybody can feel free. Because I feel pretty confident that if I sit down with a filmmaker and they ask me for what they're looking for, I can usually get it for them. But I'm also like, there's certain things I do really well. Like I do melody really well. And I really like what I do with themes. And
so how do you do that with the melody? Do you have to scribe the notes or do you?
No, I mean, you know, you feel funny. It, you hear it. You're sitting in the studio, but there's like no outboard gear. I have a computer that I literally do everything on. I'm not a gear guy. I'll go into studios afterwards and I'll re-record some stuff and I'll put real instruments in. But a lot of the stuff that I do is what's called in the box. Like I'll use fake strings and I'll use fake drums and just to kind of get the idea. It's how films work. Like it's a lot of edits. So it doesn't pay to have a violin player come in here and play violin.
Right.
If you're going to have to redo it later, you do that at the end. You know, my basic pitch, if you were a director, I'd be like, okay, here's what we need to figure out. We need to figure out what kind of score you want. That means like, what colors are we painting it? You know, do you want it to feel orchestral? Do you want it to feel like more grounded? And 80% of the work is in the first three cues that we do together. Once we establish the language of the film, it's all really loaded on the front end until we get some momentum. And especially, you know, I've worked with a few directors a couple times, but it's a lot of first-time directors, so I'm kind of explaining how the process works. Like, I'll send you an idea. It won't be perfect because I don't want to spend all my time perfecting something that's not there. So I want to give you something that you get the gist of. And if that feels good, we can fix it and let's move forward, and then we can refine and we can develop this thing. So there's this whole process that I have because the composer community is so far flung and not as cohesive as people that tour in bands together. I don't generate jobs because there's no filmmakers that live here. And that's how you get work. Like, it's 100%, I'll say 98% of how you get work is that you hang out with your buddies and somebody gets a TV show and they're like, oh, my buddy's a composer, which is a distinct disadvantage of being here and why it's like part of my tension of being in Vermont. Because it's like, I guess, what was the question? What's the most frustrating part?
There we go.
A million percent.
You'd find 100% it eventually.
Is being in Vermont and trying to hustle for jobs and just like that community doesn't exist here. But again, it's like, holistically, I have to think about where can I afford to live? My kids are in public school. All of my family's here. My wife's family's here. There's a reason that Vermonters are all so, like, it's a very wholesome place.
So it's your 25th, right? 25 years of Guster?
25 years in the band, yeah.
So, you know, we saw you at Paradise.
Sorry,
at the Paradise.
Yeah. Was that during what part of my sickness? Was it night one, two, three, or four?
It was the second night.
Oh, the second night was fine.
Yeah, that's where we met you upstairs.
You were sick?
So I got so sick on nights 3 and 4. Couldn't sing. Night one was great. Two was I was fine.
Yeah.
And three started to go. And night 4, I opened my mouth for the first note, and the entire crowd gasped, like in horror. Like,
you had a ton of stuff going on that weekend.
Too much stuff. And I was sick. And it was January, and it was like worst feeling I ever had. That's all I asked. Why you saw us? But
yeah,
it was good.
It was second.
But I remember looking in the crowd and seeing I guess, what do they call them? Gusteroids?
Yeah.
Gusteroids?
It's a play on hemorrhoids, obviously.
I got that one.
And Guster.
And Guster.
I got that, but was that
can't put anything past you guys.
Professional. Was that self-named, or did you guys
name? For sure. No, it was for sure from us.
Oh, it was from you guys. Yeah. Okay.
Nice. So, I don't think anybody's going to self-identify as a hemorrhoid, but maybe I'm wrong.
I always like watching the crowd a lot.
You
know, after 25 years, and we were all getting up there in years now, it's got to be so fulfilling.
I mean, the thing is, we kind of talked about this a lot. It was like, we're not going to just sit in the back of a room and play music for music's sake. You know, part of what we've done from the very beginning is we want people to hear our music.
Yeah.
And it doesn't necessarily or overtly affect the kind of music that we want to make, but we're not in it for the pure joy of playing in a room with each other. Part of it is this connection, is going out and having a microphone and singing and performing and feeling an energy put out and come back to you, and having true empathy in terms of being a fan of people and being out in an audience and feeling that and being like,
well, and you're creating that moment for them.
Exactly.
And live time. And Martin Sexton talked about this, where he was able to sort of articulate that as well with just one dude and his voice and his guitar. And it was like this preacher moment where breathing with the audience and this kind of stuff.
When he does his thing and he's in it in a way, and we've spent some time, not a ton of time on the road. I think we were on a tour, maybe it was John Mayer or something, and watching him do his thing so specifically, where it was him solo, and you're just like, a force of nature, where he's just like doing his solos. There was some weird pedal, and you're like,
well, his voice
is doing it. Yeah, from the very beginning.
Is an instrument.
We came on stage, I saw him in Martha's Vineyard. He came on stage, didn't get even near the microphone, just walked up to the stage, and everyone's still kind of talking and milling around. They didn't even see him come on. And he just started singing. He started singing America. He did his own little version of America the Beautiful. And just quieted.
It's pretty awesome.
Yeah,
it was freaking therapy. It was great. It was like therapy,
And it's funny, you know, having kids obviously changes everything in your life, and also watching my kids see me as a performer and watching them kind of play. My daughter said the other day that she wanted to perform, like she's taking harp lessons, like actual harp, not like
big harp.
She's not with Seth Iacovone on the harmonica.
I'm like, what do you mean harp? No, you're not taking harp lessons. And then she asked again. I was like, wait, I'm a musician. I should be supportive. But yes, she's doing it. And now she's taking harp lessons. Today she'll have harp lessons. She's like thinking about being a performer. And I'm trying to remember what I said, but I said this much more articulately. But I was like, for me, it's much more about expressing myself than getting attention. If you want to perform because there's something you feel like you need to say or something you want to articulate in a musical or visual or physical way, that's one thing. What I was trying to say in a very I'm trying to be a good parent here is like, it's kind of good for it to come from that way rather than be like, hey, look at me. Hmm. I think that's a very crucial thing that I was trying to explain to my kids about what I do early on. Like, it's not attention for the sake of attention, because kids obviously have a whole complicated relationship with attention and all that. For me, it's about trying to speak from my heart and say something I want to say. Like, if it comes from there, I feel like it will always land in the right place. But there are some kids, especially like, you know, 7, 8, 9, 10, who are like, hey, look at me, I'm crazy, I can do this.
There's a certain self-absorption that's sort of normal.
But I don't think that that's my kids at all, actually. I know that they're not. I can already sense like who they are as like true beings, but I don't think I'm here because I just need the attention. I think it's part of it. Obviously, I like the attention, but I also like the community and being able to say, like, those moments at Paradise where you're just like, oh, shit, man, look what we get to do. We get to be friends and make this stuff and work really hard, and then we get to do this in front of all these people, and then it's connecting in a way that, like, other bands make me feel.
Do you have those moments in the middle of a song?
There were moments, like, and Adam said the same thing. He was like, I felt kind of choked up at certain points.
You allow taping of your shows?
Yeah, we do. I mean, we allowed taping for our shows very early on just to be fan-friendly.
Yeah, sure.
It was part of our ethos. We play, like, satellite pretty much the same way every night for the last 20 years. I mean, there's no reason to collect, like, a cool version of whatever. We don't really improvise. I mean, we make up songs from time to time, but...
I love that about your vibe, too, because you're expressive, it's different, it's melodic... But people are not there for all the same reasons that someone goes to a Fish show. But they connect in the same way with each other.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's almost like Dave Matthews is almost, I've always thought of as a combination of those two things.
Yep. But he's more of a jammer, though.
It is, it's organized jamming.
But the thing is about you guys, it's there's a lot of humor in there.
Right. Yeah, Dave's funny, but he's funny in like a much drier, darker, way subversive way. I feel like there's a handful of bands who really, I think about this, I don't really say it, but in my mind, I really think about those dudes that like go into the mountain and they're like, all right, we want to go to the other side of the mountain and we're just going to take this chisel and we're going to make our own path. And we're not going to follow Dave and Fish. And I think Wilco, as of late, especially with their festivals and the way they're putting out records, maybe even Weezer, like there's a handful of bands who have been around for 20 years who just kind of like, well, we're kind of a radio band, but we're really not anymore. And we cruise along and have a career and all different levels. Like there's a handful of jam bands, even Umphrey's McGee, who I have no relationship.
I love Umphrey's
whatsoever.
McGee.
I'm like, Avett Brothers this summer when they came to town. I was like, right?
You saw them at Tinglewood?
No, I saw him here in Vermont.
I saw him at Tinglewood.
What about My Morning Jacket?
I mean, Jacket's very similar, and it's I know those guys really well. I saw them twice this summer, and similar thing, where they just, like, they're kind of just doing their thing, and Jim is a fucking weirdo, and, like, all those dudes are really cool and total musicians, and what else do you want? Like, they haven't been on the radio in forever. I don't think they're, like, cool blog band anymore. I don't know, like, Z was one of my favorite Jacket records, and I haven't really made a record that had touched me in the way that that one has, but I love some of their new stuff. It's just, like, where it came in at that time, and so that gives me real empathy about how people access our band. I'm like, oh, maybe it's like Guster the Jacket, where it's like, oh, I love a couple of the new tunes, but man, that whole fucking record Z is like start to finish. I just listened to 1,000 times. I haven't spent the same time. I don't know.
Yeah.
You into vinyl? You guys, all your music comes out in vinyl, doesn't
it? Yeah, everything but the first record now. My impetus for going to vinyl was just my kids, because what basically was happening is we were listening to music every morning, and my wife is yelling at me not to be on a screen in the morning. I'm like, yeah, but I'm building a playlist. Like, I want to make sure. And I was like, oh, you're right. So I had collected vinyl a little bit when I was in Brooklyn and New York. There was a really cool vinyl store down the street that was like, I go and I look at the prices for stuff. I'm like, wait, I bought Tusk for $1 and I bought like, you know, Nielsen Schmielsen for like $3 back then. Like the whole Talking Heads catalog for under $5. Like I was just picking stuff up. So now my kids flip the record. They look at and it's not at all for me. It's not an audiophile at all. Like I have $100 stereo to listen to. Like I can't tell the difference between the hi-hi. Plus I'm half deaf anyway, but for me, it was the way we interface with records and listening to an artist and being like, this is side A and this is side B. And also just because I'm lazy, a lot of times we're listening to vinyl, we'll listen to like the same record 3 or 4 times in a row.
Yeah. So on the one side.
Yeah, or one side, or flip it over and just keep flipping it. Yeah.
We were talking about that yesterday.
So it's like, it's cool. It's weird that that's how I'm kind of listening to music. I love this band, The, and they were like a big band in the 80s.
Remember them?
We've been listening to it for the last couple of days, just kind of flipping it over in the mornings. So we get ready, and my daughter was singing on the way to school, and I'm like, all right, this is how it works. Like, the way the world works right now and the way I work is so fragmented. There's so many things. Like, if we could take a slow roll on just like, this is a band's moment in time. This is what they tried to create, start to finish as a statement. More than anything, it just got me into record stores again. I was such a collector of music. 10,000 CDs at a certain point, and I was just buying stuff. And but then there was a point I remember for like 5 years where I would go past a record store and be like, well, why am I going to go in there? I'm doing everything on streaming. I'm Spotify. But by the way, it's also incredible because if someone's like, hey, did you hear this super weird, like obscure Lee Hazelwood track? And then you go on and we can do it in 5 seconds. There's a lot of value in that.
Well, you're right. With streaming and MP3 and all this stuff, it's like you have the best of both worlds. It's crazy how you can experience it in different ways.
It's the greatest. Yeah. Like, I would never demean it. I mean, especially because I'm being very proactive about my kids' musical education, where I'm just sort of like, cool, like, we're going to start listening to this, and I don't own all this stuff.
Right.
It's like, well, let's try this. Oh, that didn't work. Let's move around. Like, what I'm trying to do really is just to get the records that are really important to me. Like, I'm super into food. I like basically find the coolest, weirdest food in any city, and where's the weirdo record shop? And it allows me to like get in there and just kind of crate dig and be like, oh, I never had this McCartney solo record. I never thought I wanted to hear Pipes of Peace, but maybe I do, you know? And then you go home and you listen to it and you're like,
and you actually meet people also. It's not like just in your silo and in like the social media.
Oh, the community's great. The vinyl thing is super fun just because it's another way to interface with music. And it does end up just by its nature being a little bit backward looking, which I think is kind of cool, of like filling in gaps with like, I'm mostly going back and buying like The Cure Disintegration because that was just one of the biggest records ever for me. And I just know I'm never going to get tired of it.
The vinyl stuff all comes full circle. I have to, you know, when we texted about John Sarkin.
Oh, yeah.
It was like blew my mind.
Yeah, he's amazing.
He's an interesting guy. It's a whole other concept. Oh, you know, I told you about this where he did an album cover. I don't know which album it was. It was
Easy, Guster on the Top. Yeah, it's two ago.
He's amazing, just creative mind. Talk about doing what you do, marching your own drummer. He had a brain injury. He had a cerebellar hemorrhage like 30 years ago, and he talks about this. And he's, have you seen his whole, he has a presentation where he brings in art and music. And all of a sudden, I'm at this conference, arts and medicine type of thing, and brain injury actually. And it says Guster.
Yeah.
We were going to meet in a couple days.
He's incredible.
So bizarre.
It's funny that he would sort of put that in his thing.
He put your video too, the one where he painted you.
Yeah, I mean, there was just a mutual friend. Brian and his wife Meg had a friend in Gloucester who just happened upon him. And also,
that's right. He's in Rockport, Gloucester.
We have a mutual friend, this guy, Chad, who's a total maker, and saw Sarkin and just kind of knew to connect us. His art is so specific in a way and so outside of any other parameters and so inspired. And I mean, when Chad told us about it, he was in an old fish stick factory in Gloucester said that 50,000 square foot warehouse and like every room was just filled with art. Yeah. And all of it, you could just, like, every when I remember day. The first time when I walked in, I just like literally picked up something underneath my feet and I was like, this is incredible.
Yeah.
And like
every day for 12 hours a day, he creates art since his injury. And it's a whole other story, but I mean, it's really inspiring.
It's inspiring because it's so good.
It's good stuff.
It's so good.
Anybody listen to this, John Sarkin, Sarkin. Really interesting stuff.
And you should totally talk to that guy. I would love to hear that conversation.
Yeah, he was a chiropractor, you know.
I know. He was a chiropractor. He had a stroke on a golf course and woke up and never had done art before and then couldn't stop drawing. It's the only
never
way
did
to
art
put
before.
It together. Wait, did you tell him that we were...
I had a picture.
Did he say
anything? Oh, he totally... Yeah, I mean, he loved the experience. He loved working with you guys. You know,
Dude. What I wouldn't do to have met another version of him, like the pre-Art John, just to see what the through line would be. I'm just so inspired by him and his literally, if nothing else, his art, just like what he makes every day. It just really resonates with me.
Well, there's a part of him that always is the same guy, that always was, I think. I don't know what that is.
I don't know the other guy. Who's the other guy?
Yeah.
My last question.
Any dangling participles here?
What's next? You're composing right now for a film.
Yeah.
But what else is next for you?
I'm doing films. I'm doing some songwriting for films. Any solo stuff? I just started a new band with these guys from Providence, which I've never really done before, which is like a really fun... I got asked to do a show and Guster wasn't available. They said, will you do it solo? And I said, yes. And it's like, this is how much money we're going to pay you. I was like, that's a lot of money for me to be a shitty acoustic guitar player. There's a band I really love from Providence called Arc Iris. They're super musical.
Oh, we were just talking about that.
Yeah, so I
love them.
I love them, and I've been friends. They've stayed here. I was like, hey, do you want to be my band? Let's like make something for the show. And Jocelyn, the singer, was like, is this for a one-off, or do you want to do this in the future? And I was like, well, let's. I drove down to Providence, Rhode Island on like a Tuesday. I got there, and we wrote 5 songs in 2.5 days, which is so fast considering like Guster just takes a much longer time because of the way it works.
And well, you created them together.
This whole project. Wrote in a room, and like the songs are good. And then we played the show, and it was really good. And we like dressed in matching outfits, and it was really magical.
What's the name of the band?
I think we're called Bwahaha.
Because
I wrote the
with
name.
With a W?
B-W-A.
Oh, Bwahaha.
Yeah, like I wrote to her the name of a band. I think it was a suggestion, and I wrote Bwahaha. And she's like, is Bwahaha your name? I was like, no.
It is now.
It's like, oh, that's a great band.
It's a great name for a band. Always comes up on this one.
So now we have this thing that I don't know what we're going to do. We're trying to, I finished demos the other day. Like, we recorded something, so now we're going to just like put it out there in the universe and see how it kind of picks up. So that's a thing. I'm working on figuring out this TV show. And if that's like, I met a couple people in Vermont recently that I really want to interview. So I thought that I had kind of reached like the stories I wanted to tell.
Well, there's more friends to make.
I think
there's always more friends to make.
Like, there's no way I'm going to like peak. I'm going to max out on this. This is like part of who I am at this point. Like I'm doing this thing. So
we got to check out Bwahaha, you know, because we saw Arc Iris, me and my buddy Ike, you know, it was performance art with music together, what they wear and how they connect.
I mean, I love Zach and Ray and Jossie are incredible. And I've seen him here a few times actually. And usually it's just a room full of musicians with their jaws on the floor. So an opportunity to make music with them was really great. And it was one of those things like, I don't think I want to like go in the van and go play the haunt in Ithaca. Like, I don't want to go like play the Middle East upstairs and like try and get a following. Like, I would like for us to play cool festival things or soft ticket things and maybe write some songs and maybe get it in a movie. And like, this can be one of the things that you guys do because they do a bunch of crazy shit. And I'm trying to fill my life with that kind of stuff. Shit, moving forward, it's like, I don't know. I'm reading a book about Buddhism. Like, I want to start meditating. I'm serious. Like,
I know Dalton was a big fan of Trippin' Balls, I think.
Yeah, Trippin' Balls is definitely another thing.
That was one of the first names, or what was that again?
No, it's our fake band where we opened up for ourselves.
Oh, yeah.
And we had
one
song.
Yeah.
Trippin' Balls is a band that has one song. It's 30 minutes long called Trippin' Balls.
Right.
It's really good.
Okay. 30 minutes long.
And, like, people didn't know it was us because we were in, like, full wigs and sunglasses and they hated us. And, like, we're the same band you're going to see, like, 10 minutes
from Dalton told us a story.
You got to miss the opener. Just go see Gus. Don't see Trippin' Balls.
Yeah, I'm in a point in my life where I'm really trying to like open things up, and the Guster record is obviously like a really big priority, and we've been writing songs, we sent out some demos to some pretty high level producers that are pretty indie rock and pretty cool, and a lot of them come back as being like, these are great songs. So it's important for us to have recognition from peers that are making really awesome records that are like, it's been a real struggle for us to have started off as one kind of band and end up as a different kind of band and being put in a category of like, oh yeah, you guys are strummy bongo band. It's like, well, no, we're kind of a weirdo indie rock pop band, but but that's not really where we are. So like, our records keep getting weirder. I mean, Richard Swift is the weirdest producer we ever made with, and it's the furthest out we've ever been, and we're gonna keep going further out.
So is it a family thing? It's brothers?
Oh yeah.
Because I mean, Greg did want me to ask you. Greg got us together today, and I want to give a shout out to Greg.
Greg.
Way to go, G-Max.
I think the ATO was like one of the first times you ever saw you play at his house.
Oh my God, I live there probably because of him, too.
His question is basically, how the f*** have you guys stayed together?
Well, it's a lot of just like growing up like together and realizing that the sum of the parts is, you know, that there was something special that being in front of all these people. I have this experience with Bwahaha, for example, where I'm like, wow, these guys are amazing. And I mean, Zach and Ray are like insane. Like, they went to School of Rock. They're prodigious players. And so you're like, oh, this is all I want to do. And then you're like, oh, well, we just wrote 4 or 5 cool songs. But then you go and you like play with your band. You're like, oh, wait, there's like history here. And there's feelings and there's emotion and there's like... It's so much different. Not that I compare them, but there is a little bit of that thing of like, well, that was really fun and new and exciting, and I'm learning all a new language, and we're all being in this room together. And it's so much, like, for someone like me that's just like gets off on like new stuff, it's like the tendency is just be like, where's the shiny object? And I'll just go chase it. So to have this other thing in my life that is literally like the Titanic, it grounds everything I do.
Guster's
like
grounding,
it's part of my identity.
Yeah, yeah.
I have a lot of respect for that, and that's why I really honor it. And I respect, you know, obviously the people, but the music and our fan base, and I really want to do right. That's why it takes us a long time to make records, because we want to make records that we can listen to in 10 years. And so there's a lot of that stuff that goes into it. So it is the thing that kind of drives it and is totally inextricably linked with my identity in a way that I take ownership of, and I'm very honored by.
This is the only time we have. There are no more lives left. Take the good and take the bad. This is the only time we have. This is the only time we have. This universe of grain of sand. Let's take the good and take the bad. This is the only time we have. I know it's obvious, but I've chosen to believe it. I know it's simple, but this choice it is for good. This is the only time we have. I know it's simple, but I happen to believe it. I know it's obvious, but the choice it is for good.
You can find more about Ryan and Guster at guster.com, and you can also watch Makin' Friends with Ryan Miller at vermontpbs.org/makin'friends. There's no G in there. Go to abovethebasement.com, where you can also sign up for our newsletter, listen and subscribe to our podcast, like our Facebook page, follow us on Twitter, and look at all the nice pictures we post on Instagram. We are everywhere. On behalf of Ronnie and myself, thanks for listening. Tell your friends, and remember, Boston music, like its history, is unique.